One of Shestov's early and short and in some ways fairly systematic, or at least continuous works, is Penultimate Words. And we'll talk about what penultimate means in just a moment. What I want to focus on here as we begin is talking a little bit about the structure and the genre of this work. Instead of being the way some of his works are, a bunch of aphorisms connected together, arranged around certain themes, instead what he has are longer passages, each of which has a title, and they're arranged in an order that is a little bit tighter than in some of his other works. So these can be read as a sort of continuous text, going from point to point to point. You're going to see some of the same themes that show up in other Shestov's works, for example, his critique of Kant and his sort of limited acceptance of Hume, saying Hume didn't actually go far enough and Kant didn't learn the right things from Hume. His commitment to a kind of pluralism that we'll talk about. You're going to see these same themes coming up over and over again and treated. So what is penultimate? If we say that something is penultimate, we're saying that it has almost the highest status, not quite the highest status, or not quite the final status. It's not the last word on something, it's the second to last word, or the second to last paragraph. Why would he give us a bunch of penultimate words? Well, because Shestov thinks that the ultimate words can't really be said, or can't fully be comprehended, or if they can be said and comprehended, they can't be communicated effectively among people. There's some problems with taking on any sort of doctrine like this. He's not the only person to say things like this. Bergson is saying some similar things around the same time in his essay on the immediate givens of the consciousness. There's a problem in saying anything along those sort of lines, because how are we actually talking about ultimate things then? And how can we criticize the possibility? But this is the problem that all mysticism is faced with. But he is right. It's not necessarily impossible, but it's inherently difficult. It's inherently fraught with possibilities for going astray. The personal, the relational intervenes when we talk about ultimate things. This is a theme, by the way, that's going to show up in other existentialist thinkers, particularly other religious existentialist thinkers like Gabriel Marcel, for example. This need to take account of the role that our what we bring to the ultimate things has to do with our ability to take them in and to think about them and communicate them and to sort of commune with them. So penultimate. We're dealing with almost the highest, almost the last. It's going to be somewhat fragmentary. It's going to be not giving the very last possible word on something. And now you notice I have some other words put up here on the board. And there's quite a few other ones that we could throw up there as well. But I have these here particularly because one of the key themes of this work is the nature of truth. That runs throughout the entire work, and how philosophy as a practice, as a discipline, as a history of other people making attempts at that, how that has something to do with generating truth, and whether, here's the question, whether it has to be conditioned by logic, or whether perhaps trying to insist on it being conditioned by logic isn't a sign of a failure of thinking things through and putting things into a straitjacket that they can't actually thrive within. So along with logic comes this notion of necessity. And this is a very Shestovian theme, that necessity is not what it really is made out to be, that ultimately necessity does depend on something that is not necessary, that seems almost arbitrary, almost whim, in a Dostoevsky kind of sense of the term. And that's choice. human choice too, not just sort of chance or, you know, as Descartes called it, a concatenation of things coming together in an almost random way, but rather the choice of a person who already has sensibilities, who is committed, who has a narrative, who has a history. That actually gives me a good idea about where I should start, something I've been trying to think about. You know, originally I wanted to just sort of run through the book in a sequential way, and then I thought, it doesn't really work very well with Shestov, the way it does with many other authors, just because of the way he writes. And now I know exactly where I ought to begin, and it's with the third paragraph, or the third passage, which is titled Eternal Truths. And he brings up how Xenophon, in his memorabilia, tells of Socrates meeting with Hippias. And Hippias is a sophist. So these sophists are people who went around Greece, and in the sort of, you know, telling of the story that Xenophon and Plato even more give of what's going on in Greece at the time, you've got, you know, a lot of moral decay and a lot of sort of contradictory voices about what the good is, what kind of life we ought to be living, you know, what sort of values ought to be held. And there's a lot of social change happening, and there's, you know, accompanying this isn't an expression of it, wars and conflicts and new economic developments. And Socrates is a critic of the sophists. The sophists were people who would go around Greece, and for the most part they would teach rhetoric, but they would also teach, they claimed to teach other disciplines as well. And they would teach for a fee. They were the first sort of guest worker academicians. And Socrates thought that they were given to a kind of moral corrosion that wasn't good for the young, and a lot of other people thought this too. And as a matter of fact, quite a few people thought that Socrates himself was a sophist, wrongly. But, you know, that's part of what he was charged with, ultimately, by his old accusers, as he talks about in the Apology. So anyway, that's some background. So Socrates and Hippias run into each other, and Hippias says this famous thing to him, something that not only Plato picked up on, and Xenophon picked up on, but Kierkegaard would pick up on, and Shestov picks up on. So you're still saying the same old things that I heard from you years ago. And Socrates says, yeah, I'm actually consistent. How about you? You know, and this is kind of a good way to turn the critique on its head. And most people, particularly philosophers, they'll look at that passage and say, aha, Socrates won. He showed that, you know, logic, necessity, consistency, those are the things that are fundamentally important. It doesn't matter whether we're talking about cobblers and shoes, which is what, you know, he gets criticized for doing the same discussions about over and over again. It doesn't matter what our content is. So long as you're actually consistent, you're doing the right thing, you're on the right track, you're going to be the one who ultimately knows truth. Shestov says, you know, I'm not really that sure that Socrates was in the right there. This is a really interesting thing to say. He says, Socrates lived 70 years. He was once a youth, once a man, once a graybeard. What if he had lived 140 years, experienced once again all the three seasons of life, and had met Hippias again? Or better still, if the soul, as Socrates taught, is immortal, and Socrates now lives somewhere in the moon or Sirius or in some other place predestined for immortal souls, does he really go on plaguing his companions with discourses on justice, carpenters, and smiths? And does he emerge victorious as of old from the dispute with Hippias and other persons who dare to affirm that everything may be and ought to be subject to the laws of time, and that mankind not only loses nothing, but gains much by such subjection? So what Shestov is saying is that, well, let's look at it two ways. What if Socrates actually lived a double life, or make it twice, or infinite amounts of time? Would he still value this consistency, which he treats almost as something that he has faith in, Or would he start to say, you know, actually, Hippias and his ilk are quite correct about the fact that time reveals to us, going through the processes, reveals to us how many things that we take for being so certain aren't really certain at all. That they're actually things that we can look at as certain, but we should understand as that depending ultimately on our choice or temperament or commitment. And we should ask, why are we doing that then? The other flip side of this is actually, you know, in the Apology, Socrates says, yeah, you can kill me, and you can send me down to the underworld, and there I'm going to have judges who don't kill you for asking questions. And I'm going to bother all the ancient heroes asking them the same sort of questions that I'm asking my countrymen up here. And it's going to be so great because now I'm finally going to have people who actually know something and I can get the straight dope from them. Is that really what would happen? Or is that sort of a projection on Socrates' part, and then, you know, Plato mirroring him? What if when he got to the underworld, he realized, wow, I actually committed myself to the wrong things? Or there's no point to trying to gather all of this knowledge and attain perfect certainty that can withstand or supply a kind of necessity that's not in my experience. Now, where would you go after this? So this is why I have these terms, dogmatism and skepticism, up here. The dogmatist is the person who is committed to some sort of philosophical perspective, and by philosophical perspective, I would just think broad, you know, about the universe, about human nature, about good and evil, about God or the lack of God or gods, about how all these things connect with each other, about what communication is, about what truth is, about what knowledge is, sort of big picture stuff that resists being turned into a narrow science, but is nonetheless necessary in order to think things out, to find one's way in one's environment with one's capacities. So a dogmatist is somebody who has a particular point of view, and quite often it's very consistent so long as you remain within that point of view. The term comes about in Hellenistic philosophy when the Stoics and the Epicureans were called dogmatists as opposed to the skeptics. Skeptic means searcher, or the one who's looking into things. And if you stick with that original meaning, then skepticism means something quite different than what it comes to mean. Skepticism eventually becomes a stance that's actually quite dogmatic in its own right. This is, well, we just can't know anything. So for any argument, we'll give a counter argument, and we just won't commit ourselves to anything. So imagine Descartes around meditation 2 without any of the rest of the meditations. Or imagine a sort of pared down David Hume. Or think of the ancient skeptics that were what Plato's Academy ultimately turned into. Now, both of these are actually flip sides of the same coin. And they're both operating within this kind of mindset. What Shestov wants to say, and he's saying this throughout this work, and other works as well, but in this work, probably it's crystallized to a greater extent than anywhere else. He talks about, and he doesn't use this term, we can speak of a plurality or pluralism of philosophical perspectives. And that's sort of a revolutionary point of view in philosophy. And I don't think that he has in mind by his plurality or his pluralism what a lot of exponents of pluralism these days actually seem to mean by it, which is oftentimes just a refined form of skepticism or its own form of dogmatism where everything is compartmentalized. You can be a pluralist by... Let me actually put this up on the board. This is two models of pluralism. So here's model one. What a lot of people these days seem to think of when we talk about everybody having their own point of view or having the freedom to decide for themselves. And it's essentially something that's coming from a hard-won achievement of liberal political theory. Liberal in the sense that both liberals and conservatives, what we call conservatives today, are liberals. And it's a compartmentalization. And you might have some that are, you know, bigger, that command more adherence, and you might have some that absorb others, but you have these point of views, and they'll have to sort of respect each other, but they're ultimately impermeable to each other. They don't share the same basic grounds. Or then there's the pretense that, hey, we all are committed to the same live and let live notion, but you're going to live it out this way and I'm going to live it out this way. There's a kind of fakeness to that. Something Shestov rejects that kind of thing. I myself find it kind of repugnant, this notion, because it always conceals somebody dominating somebody else. Somebody making some sort of imperatives for somebody else. Here's a different way of looking at it. We overlap with each other. This is like a crazy Venn diagram with, you know, all sorts of things, you know. Who knows what these are supposed to represent. Ultimately, you know, maybe materialism, idealism, Hegelian idealism, Royceian idealism. We could come up with all sorts of views with this. But here's the point. The different perspectives, to a great degree, end up not only overlapping with each other, but introducing sort of conflicts within the person who has to address the fact that if they're here, are they really belonging to this or are they belonging to this? Choice becomes involved, and not just the sort of arbitrary pick your side and take your chances kind of thing, but one where we're actually able to have reasonable discussions with each other and communicate and feel doubts. This is a universe that is in many respects nobler and broader than this one. There's something pinched, something tawdry about this kind of universe of thought. So, Shestov is committed to a kind of pluralism, and that's a good place for us to go at this point. So we're skipping ahead a little bit. And we'll come back to some of the earlier things. Here's something that he says, and this is in section 6, which is entitled Swan Songs. And it's not primarily about this, but this is a very important passage in it. He's talking about Socrates, Plato, the Jewish prophets, and he says Tolstoy is like them, in that they had to concentrate their powers wholly on one gigantic inward task. They had to find some sort of center that they were focused upon. The condition of its successful performance being the illusion that the whole world, the whole universe, works in concert and unison with them. They are finally grasping the whole, the all, the principles of things, the ultimate words, not the penultimate, but the ultimate words. And he says, evidently, great men are very little inclined to initiate the outsider into the secret of their great deeds. Evidently, they cannot themselves give a clear account of the character and meaning of the tasks which they set themselves. There's a kind of, not so much blindness or even lack of self-knowledge, but an inattentiveness, an inability to see that part of themselves. On a very, you know, much lower level, I'm not trying to compare myself to, say, Socrates or Tolstoy or anybody like that. When it comes to these videos, I'm always surprised that people are watching them and that they like this sort of, you know, talking stuff, because I can't figure out what's appealing about it. But apparently they, you know, they're good. So I think something very similar to that, but on a much higher level, is what Shestov is talking about happening with, say, Plato, or the Jewish prophets, or Tolstoy, or even comedians like Heine and Gogol, who he talks about in here. Now, where's he going with this? He says, Belief and the need of belief are as strong as love, as strong as death. In the case of every dogmatist, I can now consider it my sacred duty to concede everything in advance, even to the acknowledgement of the least and least significant shades of his convictions and beliefs. Shestov is willing to say, dogmatist, you believe this thing, I'm willing to go along with you. But I require one thing of you. And this is something that most dogmatists are not willing to grant, and most skeptics are not willing to grant, and most people committed to that sort of balkanized form of pluralism are not willing to allow either. What is it? There's but one limitation, one only, imperceptible and almost invisible. The dogmatist's convictions must not be absolutely and universally binding. That is, not binding upon the whole of mankind without exception. So he's willing to say, you've got a dogmatist. And what is a dogmatist without a dogma? Right? A bundle of ideas. And they can apply to nearly everyone. So we have humanity. And we can think of this in terms of the mass. And we can also even think of this in terms of elites. And this can be completely binding on them. Why? Because they're willing to go along with that. But there must be the exceptions. It must be allowed that some people escape from the grasp of that necessity. He says, the majority, the vast majority, millions, even tens of millions of people, I will readily allow them on the understanding that they themselves desire that. You know, if in a particular age, most people are materialists and therefore materialist philosophers, you know, jibber-jabber all day long about materialism and how it's the only way that it could possibly be, they can do that because these people are giving into that. If you're in an age of faith and many people don't have some sort of genuine faith but are living out something that's basically superstition and ignorance and a form of dogma that they just say, well, it sounds good to me. If the majority of people are living a consumerist lifestyle and somebody comes along and tells them really what life is about is consuming and there can't be anything other than that, and to not do that is to not be a good conservative or not be a good liberal, because actually they both say things along those lines, just with different products. One goes to Sam's Club, the other goes to Costco. It's because this mass accepts that the dogmatist is given the capacity to do that. But if the dogmatist is going to really remain in touch with truth, the dogmatist's convictions must not be absolutely and universally binding. He says, in other words, I allow him almost the whole of humankind, in consideration whereof he must agree that his convictions are not intrinsically binding on the few units that remain. I agree to an outward submission. And the dogmatist, after such a victory, my confession is surely a complete victory for him, must consider himself satisfied in full. What's interesting is that dogmatists very often don't consider themselves satisfied in full until they have effaced all of these, and they've got everybody saying that this must be the case. This is where we see so many, and I hate to use this word because it has a proper use that is not of this sort, but evangelists of this movement or that movement, who are usually, when you actually sit down with them and spend time with them, very earnest people, but in certain ways cracked, flawed, like all the way down to the bottom. And there's a desire, a hunger to control, to have power, to push their views. Shestov says, look, you can believe in whatever you want, and it can be as consistent as you like. Just don't say that everybody has to subscribe to it. Some metaphysics can take that. Others can't. I think there are some, you know, classic philosophies that actually can go along with that Shestov himself kind of ignored, but that's a topic for another day. A little bit later, he says, this is in his section, What is Philosophy? And he says, look, when it comes to philosophy, people have been debating about this for a long time, and some people have taken this to be a massive scandal. Kant, for example. No progress has been made in metaphysics at all. I'm going to sweep it all away. Even Descartes, you know, has that sort of viewpoint. There's a lot of people taking that as a sort of polemic to begin with. And I think some of them actually believe in that. Now, is that actually a vice? He says, there's no doubt that all those who've gone to philosophy for answers to the questions which tormented them have left her disenchanted unless they had a sufficiently eminent gift to enable them to join the guild of professional philosophers. From this we may unhesitatingly conclude, although the conclusion is for the time being only negative, that philosophy is engaged in a business which may be interesting and important to the few, but is tedious and useless to the many. He says, this is highly consoling for the sage as well as for the profane. For the sage is a human being. And he says, what can be more terrible to a man than to be compelled in the hard moments of his life to acknowledge any doctrine of philosophy as binding upon him? You know, the dogmatists, a lot of them are inconsistent, and they're inconsistent in moments of personal crisis. And Shestov says, well, that's exactly as you should expect it to be. You know, ideas are not made to be turned into idols, something that we must bow down to. And he goes on and he says, if there is not in philosophy one universal principle binding upon and acknowledged by all, and this is something that philosophers tend to strive for, right? He says, the essence and fundamental problem of any doctrine reduces to the subordination not merely of man's conduct, but of the life of the whole universe to one regulating principle. This is what philosophy quite often consists in, you know. For you don't have Kant without the Copernican Revolution, and things ultimately sort of, you know, reframed in terms of subjectivity. You don't have Hegel without the dialectic. You don't have, I'm actually going to refrain from making bad jokes at the expense of dull philosophers. And we'll just go on with this. So he says, if there is not in philosophy one universal principle binding upon and acknowledged by all, it means that each is permitted, that it is permitted to each man, at least for the meantime, to feel and to act in his own way. So we have the history of philosophy spread out before us. All sorts of dogmas, all sorts of systems. And if you don't like a system, you know, call it a perspective. Nietzsche has a system just as much as any systematic philosopher. You can uncover it by digging into it. And just simply, you know, railing against systems and calling it anti-systematic doesn't make it so. In any case, we have all these different systems. Shestov says we can actually pick and choose, legitimately. Doesn't mean it's totally up for grabs. And if we're very opportunistic about it, if, you know, for example, we pick up a sort of truncated version of Adam Smith minus all the sympathy part so that we could be complete bastards in the marketplace, well, then other people can come along and call us opportunistic. If we take on Rousseau because we want to feel, you know, that we've got this sentimental attachment and all this romantic stuff, well, then people can come along and call us morons. That would be a watered-down Rousseau, by the way. If we, you know, want to be utilitarians, if we want to be materialists, if, you know, pick whatever you want, you're still subject to other people coming along and saying, hey, why are you picking that? But you do get to choose. You do have that choice. There's no one thing that is universally binding, he says. A man may listen to Spinoza, or he may stop his ears. He may kneel before Plato's eternal ideas, or he may give his allegiance to the ever-changing, ever-flowing reality. Finally, he may accept Schopenhauer's pessimism. But nothing on earth can compel him to celibacy on the ground that Schopenhauer successfully laughed at love. nor is there any necessity at all, in order to win such freedom for one's own self, to be armed with the light dialectic of the old Greek philosopher, with the heavy logic of the poor Dutch Jew, that's Spinoza, or with the subtle wit of the profound German, Schopenhauer. He says, neither is it necessary to dispute them. It is even possible to agree with them all. Now, you know, if you agree with them all, people are going to call you inconsistent. And if that bothers you, well, then don't agree with them all. That's your choice. If you can actually take them all in, if you can, like Leibniz say, philosophical doctrines are true in what they affirm and generally wrong in what they deny, which seems to be a commitment to a kind of pluralism as well. And if you can live that out, if you have enough robust strength of ego to be able to withstand other people not agreeing with you, that's your prize. Then you get to say, I think this works and this works as well. He says, the room of the world is infinite and will not only contain all those who lived once and those who are yet to be born, but will give to each one of them all that he can desire. To Plato, the world of ideas. To Spinoza, the one eternal and unchangeable substance. To Schopenhauer, the nirvana of Buddhism. Each of these and all the other philosophers will find what they want in the universe, even to the belief, even to the conviction that theirs are the only one true and universal doctrines. But at the same time, the profane will find suitable worlds for themselves. A plurality of worlds, he says, a plurality of men and gods amidst the vast spaces of the vast universe. This is, if I may be forgiven the word, an ideal. It's true it's not built according to the idealists, but it is a sort of ideal. Now, Shestov is an actual religious believer. And it's interesting. You might say, well, if you accept this sort of, you know, relativistic doctrine, or even if we don't call it relativism, let's call it pluralism or voluntarism, then, you know, what becomes of religion? Well, you know, to accept the transcendent, to accept that there may be sources other than pure unaided human reason or whatever passes for reason in whatever age we're in or what counts as science, that's also something available. That's something that one could have the right to consider, to prefer, to set out there. And, of course, it can be subject to criticism. And if you try to operate your entire life and your relationships and your decisions on the basis of that, and it goes badly, there's no, you know, take-backs or saying, ah, but I believed in this idea, so therefore I escaped the consequences. But that doesn't mean that one can't choose that idea. We are radically free, according to Shestov. And this pluralism is a sort of not only a recognition of that, but a consequence of the kind of radical freedom that Shestov sees. Now let's look at what Shestov has to say about truth. So as I said at the beginning of this, one of the biggest themes of this work is exploring the nature of truth, asking this question, what is truth? And there are actually two sections towards the very end of this that have that as their title. So I'm going to come to those in a moment. I actually want to look at the section, it's the second one, which is titled Self-Renunciation and Megalomania. And I'm going to sort of bounce around in it, in part because at one point it goes right to the center of the question of truth. And he brings up Pilate. And if you remember your Gospels, one of the things that Pilate actually asks Jesus during the trial is, what is truth? And he doesn't get an answer. And people have, you know, debated about, well, why is Pilate asking this? Is it just supposed to be a joke? Is he saying truth doesn't matter compared to power? Is he genuinely searching? Is he open to finding out what truth would be? And Shestov writes about this, and he says, the old Roman Pilate, who was apparently an educated man, clever and not bad at heart, although weak in character, could neither understand nor elucidate the cause of the strange struggle which now took place before him. With his whole heart he pitied the pale Jew before him who was guilty of nothing. What is truth? He asked Christ. Christ did not answer him, nor could he answer, nor through ignorance as the heathen desired to believe. But because that question cannot be answered in words, it would have been necessary to take Pilate's head and turn it towards the other side in order that he might see what he had never seen before. Or still better, to have used the method to which the hunchback pony turns in the fairy tale in order to change sleepy Ivanushka into a wizard and a beauty, first to plunge him into a cauldron of boiling milk and then into a boiling water, then ice-cold water. There is every reason to suppose that with this preliminary preparation, Pilate would have began to act differently. Now, why is he going on about this kind of silly stuff? He wants to stress that oftentimes, because of the kind of beings that we are, that is, human beings who have wills, who have habits, who have memories, who, you know, develop ourselves in time and over time, and continue to do so through time, we often need some sort of experience to come along. And we can't predict exactly what kind of experience will do that. There's all sorts of efforts to try to shake people up. You could think about the examples of sending juveniles off to scared straight programs. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. Sometimes, you know, what should be scary to somebody doesn't turn out to be scary to them. Sometimes things that, you know, wouldn't normally be so compared to the inmates that they're encountering, a cockroach crawling across the floor, creeps them out so much that they now pay attention to something different. They attend to different features of the situation. They think upon something that they've heard 1,000 times before and never actually knew what the meaning was. That's what he's talking about here. That's something that's involved in truth. So truth requires some sort of experience, and to put it in the singular is probably the wrong thing. We should probably say experiences tied together. Now, in this section, he's talking about self-renunciation and megalomania. What do those have to do with truth? What are they, first of all? Self-renunciation is when you give things up for the sake of some other value. So fasting, for example, is self-renunciation. Humbling oneself and putting up with other people's BS and their off, you know, wrong-headed impressions of one's own actions. Their stories about that could be self-renunciation. Megalomania is the opposite. It's you know, sort of extending the self to the entire universe and saying that you are the center of the universe. So he says, we're obliged to think nothing certain can be said either of self-renunciation or of megalomania. But each one of us in his own experience knows something of the former as well as of the latter. These are human responses. So he says, To us, the most alluring questions are those to which there are no actual, no universally valid answer. I hope that sooner or later philosophy will be thus defined in contrast to science. Science has the pretension to necessity. It's always a hypothetical necessity. If you accept this, then this follows. Not an unconditioned necessity. Philosophy, actually, Shestov thinks, does wrong by trying to make itself out to be something like science. Says, philosophy is the teaching of truths which are binding on none. And you might ask yourself, this is sort of a digression, what the hell good is a truth that's binding on none if it doesn't impress itself upon us? Well, there are other values other than necessity or unanimity or being, you know, reliable in every single case or even, you know, being completely free of contradictions. There are other values that might trump that for a person, aesthetic values, for example. Values that are known through some sort of religious experience or impulse or tradition or community. We could go on and on about that sort of thing. Shestov is the philosopher of freedom, the philosopher of open doors, you might say. So, he says, going on about self-renunciation and megalomania, he says, however little they resemble one another apparently, they may be observed successively, even simultaneously, in one and the same person. The ascetic who is denied life and humbles himself before everybody, and the madman, and he brings up Nietzsche and Dostoevsky here very interestingly, like Nietzsche and Dostoevsky, who affirms that he is the light, the salt of the earth, the first in the whole world, or even in the whole universe, both reach their madness. I hope there's no necessity to demonstrate that self-renunciation, as well as megalomania, is a kind of madness. Under conditions for the most part identical, the world does not satisfy the person, and so they begin to seek for a solution. All serious seeking brings a man to lonely paths, and lonely paths, it is well known, end in a great wall which sets a fatal bound to man's curiosity. So how will we pass beyond the wall? By overturning either the law of impenetrability or equally invincible law of gravity. Shall a man become infinitely small or infinitely great? Becoming infinitely small is self-renunciation. The self gets pared more and more and more away until it's small enough to fit through the interstices, to pass unnoticed. The self that becomes infinitely great, takes on the character of the universe, is that of the megalomaniac. And like he says, if you look at religions, and you can say this the same thing about philosophies as well, the claims that the people are making, they embody these disorders. He says that in ascetic religions, the tendency to self-renunciation predominates. Now notice, Shestov is not saying that you can reduce these religions entirely to the ascetic impulse. He's saying this is what happens when these religions go too far. So, you know, what's an example? Buddhism glorifies the suppression of the individual and has for its ideal nirvana. The Greeks dreamed of titans and heroes, so that's megalomania. The Jews consider themselves the chosen people and await the Messiah. As for the gospel, and this is a very interesting thing to say, especially for a Christian, you know, which Shestov, was he just, you know, a Jew, or was he also somebody who saw in Christianity something that he couldn't put down? Well, you have to be the judge of that reading this. It says, as for the gospel, it's hard to say which method of struggle it gives the preference. On the one hand are the great miracles, the raising from the dead, the healing of the sick, the power over the winds and the sea, and on the other, blessed are the poor in spirit. So he says, throughout, the gospel is permeated with contradictions, which are not extraneous and historical, concerned with facts, because there's a lot of people who criticize the gospels because, you know, this couldn't have happened at this time, or, you know, these accounts don't match up exactly. Those are sort of besides the point. Shestov is noting something here that a lot of other people have noted as well, including Chesterton, that if you want to actually take the gospel seriously, those factual contradictions, those are the least of your problems. The biggest problems are what he calls intrinsic contradictions of mood, of ideals, as the modern man would say. What is in one chapter praised as the noblest task is in the next degraded to an unworthy labor. And so what's going on here? He says, such contradictory elements are intertwined in the gospel that men, above all those who travel the high road, who can move on one direction only and under one conspicuous flag, who have been accustomed to believe in the unity of reason and the infallibility of logical laws, could never fully grasp the teachings of the gospel, and always aspired to give to the words and deeds of Christ a uniform explanation, which should exclude contradictions and more or less correspond to the common conceptions of the work and problems of life. It's very interesting. This is sort of a digression. I used to teach religious studies classes, and one of the classes that I taught was called Jesus and the Gospel Traditions, and we'd look at the canonical and non-canonical gospels. And we'd also look at quite a bit of the literature having to do with the quest for the historical Jesus. And Schweitzer, you know, in the last century observed that much of the Jesus quester stuff was sort of like looking down a deep well. The picture that you see, or the image that you see at the bottom, is actually a reflection of your own face. So different people in reconstructing what Jesus ought to have been like, and what in the Gospels is reliable and what in the Gospels aren't, ended up basically doing philosophy and making Jesus out to be the kind of person that they wanted. So some make him out to be this revolutionary, some he's a cynic sage, some make him out to be sort of a social gospel liberal. And everybody makes him out to be something by smoothing away the contradictions. Chesterton, who I just mentioned before, says in The Everlasting Man, which is a wonderful book, that oftentimes people will contrast the Jesus of the church and the Jesus of the Gospels and say, the Jesus of the Gospels is so nice, and you know, the Jesus of the church is so mean and harsh and repellent. And he says, actually, you got it wrong. The Jesus of the church is quite often the watered down, let's, you know, smooth everything out, everybody get along. If you actually read the Gospels, this guy says tough things, things that make your head spin and that tear out your heart. And so that's what Shestov is discussing here. Now, are the Gospels just nonsense? If they were, then all, you know, works great for rationality, because there's nothing for it to try to struggle with, nothing for it to be provoked by, to think through. It can smooth everything out, and you can say, well, the things that don't make sense, the contradictions, we just get rid of them altogether. But if the Gospels actually are providing something, some sort of insight, something, maybe even if half the contradictions in some respect make sense, and half of the contradictions are complete contradictions, then the reasonable person is forced to try to grapple with that. If reason is really to extend to everything, that's the goal of philosophy, after all. So, let me move on to this discussion that he has now about truth. And he says, what is truth? Just before this, actually, in the section which is about Heinrich Heine, he says, for some reason or another, men have decided that empirical truths, that is, truths having to do with experiences of the world, like, you know, this pencil is here, now it's over here, are many, but that metaphysical truth is one. Here's what Shestov says. Metaphysical truths are actually many, but that does not in the least prevent them from living in harmony with each other. Empirical truths, like all earthly beings, are continuously quarreling and cannot get on without superior authority. But metaphysical truths, the kind of things that make up our worldviews, that actually make up our philosophies, they are a bit different. They're differently arranged, and they know nothing whatsoever of our rivalry. So that's a good starting point. So he asks about truth now. Here he's actually going to turn to some discussion about Kant and about Hume. And he says, skeptics assert truth does not exist and cannot exist. And the assertion is eaten so deep into the modern mind that the only philosophy which is spread in our own day is that of Kant, which takes skepticism as its point of departure. And this is a good thing to point out. People often say, well, you know, modern philosophy, Descartes is beginning from skepticism. Not as much as Kant. Kant really is carrying out this Copernican revolution and saying, we can't know anything about these sorts of things, because we don't have empirical knowledge of them, and we can't sort of just infer from the way our minds are put together and what we impose upon reality how they must go. So he says, Kant wasn't really interested in truth. The old metaphysic, with its arbitrary and unproven assertions, which could not bear criticism, irritated Kant. And he decided to get rid, even though by accepting the relative legitimacy of skepticism, of the unscientific discipline which he, as a teacher of philosophy, had to represent. And then Shestov says, you know, this confidence of the skeptics, this is not binding on us. Just because Kant came along and said, from now on, philosophy after me must go in these paths, we're not bound by that. And we could say the same thing about all the different dogmas of the day. It wouldn't be Kant these days. It would be things like, you know, in analytic philosophy, there's less of a canon, but there's certain norms that you're supposed to follow. And the same thing with continental philosophy. So think about, for example, somebody who's firmly committed to Marx or Nietzsche or Freud or any of the hermeneutics of suspicion. Well, there's no reason why we automatically have to accept their point of view. Just because Heidegger proclaimed the end of metaphysics doesn't mean that that's actually the case. just because, you know, Derrida came along and said something, you know, riffing on that, doesn't mean we have to buy into his thing either. Shestov is rightly pointing out that, he says, the confidence of the skeptics and Kant's deference are not in the least binding on us. Kant didn't even make good on his own projects. And he says some interesting things about miracles there, which I'm actually going to skip over. And he says, therefore the skeptics are wrong when they assert that there is no truth. Truth exists, but what's the problem? Well, truth exists, and let's sort of draw it like this. Now here's me, or Shestov, or you, and we're only able to take in a portion of it. And I don't want to, you know, say that this is like the blind men feeling the elephant, and one says it's a tail, and one says, you know, it's a rope, and another says it's a, you know, a leaf because he feels the ear, or, you know, it's a wall because he feels the side. I don't want to go down that route. What Shestov says is, we don't know all the truth in its volume, nor can we formulate that which we do know. We cannot imagine why it happened thus and not otherwise, or whether that which happened had to happen thus, or whether something else quite different might have happened. He says, once it was held that reality obeys the laws of necessity, but Hume showed us that that's not actually the case. That necessity is subjective. It's something that we read into things because of our limited views, and we could conceive of things being out here, but a lot of it we can't even really conceive of. And then he says, his idea was caught up by Kant. All of those of our judgments which have the character of universality and necessity acquire it only by virtue of our psychological organization. Then he says, it's well known that Kant did not accept Hume's deduction. Not only did he make no attempt to banish the false premises from our intellectual economy, as Hume did with the conception of necessity, but on the contrary, he declared such an attempt was quite impracticable. The practical reason suggested to Kant that though the foundations of our judgments are vitiated by their source, their invariability may be of great assistance in the world of phenomena. Great assistance. Now, that's not quite the same thing as actually knowing what's what, is it? And he says, going on, it's important when we look at philosophers, not just Kant, he's talking about Plato here, to look at what people have made of their doctrines. The second-rate philosophers, what have they done with it? The secondary sources. He says, I would recommend as a general rule this method of examining the ideas of famous philosophers by acquainting oneself with them not only in the original works, but in the expositions of their disciples, particularly of faithful and conscientious disciples. When the fascination of the personality and the genius disappears, and the naked, unadorned truth, and he puts truth in quotes there, because he doesn't mean truth in the full sense. Disciples always believe the master had the truth, and they reveal it without any embellishment or fig leaf. Only then does it become quite clear how little value are the fundamental thoughts of even the most exalted philosophers. And he goes on, he's talking about this neo-Kantian natorp and what he made of Plato. And he calls it a reductio ad absurdum of all of his master's ideas. Plato is revealed as a logical neo-Kantian, a narrow-minded savant. And does that really fit Plato? No, because that's, Plato was doing something more than just what we find in the systemization of his text. That's not where truth actually lies. So he moves on, and in the next section, more of truth. He says, perhaps truth is by nature such that its communication between men is impossible. At least the usual communication by means of language. Everyone may know it in himself, but in order to enter into communication with his neighbor, he must renounce the truth and accept some conventional lie. So, you know, let's do this now. Each is getting his own little portion of truth. And then they have to agree on something. So they agree on something, and maybe it's actually true, but it's not what they're actually talking about. Think about when we console somebody after the death in a family, and we try to talk about our feelings. Is my grief really the same as your grief? Are they interchangeable because we have the same term? Again, Bergson was making a lot of the same points about this around the same time in a very interesting way as well. And the trouble is, how can we communicate? What Shestov actually focuses on is the amount of untruth, of falsity that intrudes into our patterns of communication. And he says that's why irony and sarcasm are a necessary weapon of the investigator. The most dangerous enemy of new knowledge always has been and always will be inculcated habit. So falsity in the heart of truth. Habit, agreement. We want to use what techniques we have as human beings to shake things up, to penetrate through into truth. He says, from a practical point of view, it's much more important to a man to know the things which may help him to adapt himself to the temporary conditions of existence than those which have a timeless value. The instinct of self-preservation always proves stronger than the desire for knowledge. And so we're already at a disadvantage when it comes to really grasping truth. We're not even really sure about what the truth of truth is, or how to distinguish true truth from its facsimiles, falsities. So he says, truth exists only in order that men who are separated in time and space might establish between themselves some kind of communication, at least. That is, a man must choose between absolute loneliness with truth on the one side and communion with his neighbors and falsehood on the other. Which is the better, it will be asked? Is it better to be able to communicate, but in the process of communication to falsify things? To have to cover over what one actually feels, experiences, and for the other person to do the same? Or is it better to exist in that sort of existential loneliness of knowing the truth but not being able to fully share it and communicate it? He says there's a third way still, to accept both. That's a very interesting idea. We don't have to become the hermit, and we don't have to become the flatterer, the creature of mere appearances. He says, all men lie when they begin to speak. Our language is so imperfectly arranged that the principle of its arrangement presupposes a readiness to speak untruth. The more abstract the subject is, the more does the disposition to lie increase, until when we touch upon the most complicated questions, we have to lie incessantly, and the lie is more intolerable and coarse the more sincere we are. For a sincere man is convinced that veracity is assured by the absence of contradictions. And in order to avoid all appearance of the lie, he tries to make a logical arrangement between his opinions. Now this, Shestov considers, actually sort of a trap. Logical consistency is not actually the hallmark of truth. It is possible that truth itself contains contradictions within it, and that our approach to it embroils us in these contradictions. So he says, let us try to draw some conclusions. Here's something he says in other places. Certainly, while logic can be useful, it would be unjustifiable recklessness to refuse its services. So we shouldn't get rid of logic altogether. It is very useful for a lot of things, but there come those points in time where an insufficient logic, an irrationally rational way of looking at things constrains us and keeps us from being able to be true to truth, to be sincere with each other, sincere in a full sense. So he says, this is a really brilliant advice. First of all, when you speak, never trouble to be consistent with what you said before. That will put an unnecessary check on your freedom, which, without that additional fetter, is already chained in words and grammatical forms. We're already stuck in enough falsity just by being social creatures that we don't have to add more to it. Then he says, when you're listening to a friend or reading a book, do not assign great value to individual words or even to phrases. Forget separate thoughts and give no great consideration even to logically arranged ideas. Remember that though your friend desires it, he cannot express himself. He is caught in the same dilemma. Save by ready-made forms of speech. Your friend, the poor bastard, just like you, is stuck talking about his grief or his joy or his infatuation with the same crappy words and locutions and habits and social forms that you're stuck with. So you can actually, in a way, extend what we call the benefit of the doubt to them out of pity or compassion or not even love for the friend, but perhaps love for the truth that is available there. He says, look to the expression of his face. Listen to the intonation of his voice. This will help you penetrate through his words to his soul. Not only in conversation, but even in a written book, can one overhear the sound, even the timbre of the author's voice, and notice the finest shades of expression in his eyes and face. Do not fasten upon contradictions. Do not dispute. Do not demand argument. Only listen with attention. It's almost asking for carrying out a phenomenological attitude, and not a reduction, not a putting everything into suspense the way Husserl wanted to do with his epoche, which, by the way, is coming from skepticism. Epoche was what skeptics practiced. Rather, it's more like what the realist phenomenologists did, trying to penetrate into things, to grasp their essences, to love them, in essence. So he goes on, and the last section in this book is actually called I and Thou. Interesting, because it recalls, you know, Buber's book. And he says, the familiar expression to look into another's soul, which by force of habit at first sight seems extremely intelligible, on closer observation appears so unintelligible, one is forced to ask if it has any meaning at all. How do you see another person's soul? How do you actually grasp another person? How do you have a sort of communion between you? How can you even fully grasp their own experiences, their own attitudes? And he says, psychology is actually not that helpful with respect to this. And eventually he's going to go on and talk about the need for new methods, the need to think things through in new ways. And again, very existentialist attitude here. And he says, unfathomability is not so entirely useless to man. It was driven into our heads as children, the human mind could compass only those things which are limited. But this only proves we have yet another prejudice to get rid of. He says, I am ready to vouch for this. The world has long been weary of universal truths. Even truth pure and simple makes no whisper in my ear. We must find a way to escape from the power of every kind of truth. So what are we left with here? He's ranged over a lot of territory. Has he discarded truth altogether? No, but truth is something that we have to make our way into through life, through experience, through commitment, through choice. And we only get one chance. So we don't have the opportunity even to do the sort of Cartesian once in our life we ought to wipe away all previous prejudices. Instead, we have to look at, you know, this landscape that we're provided with, in which it's difficult to communicate. And there are all sorts of dogmatic perspectives. And what we need to realize is that we're not necessarily bound by any of them. That's a scary thought for many people. The notion that we actually have the freedom to choose between these things and that we have to accept the consequences of those choices. Shestov is saying this long before people like Sartre, who are attributed this doctrine, are saying this. So that's a good place to leave off. That is a lot of what's going on in Penultimate Words. There's much more that I didn't talk about, his discussions of Heine and Gogol and many other very interesting topics, but there you have at least the nutshell of it.